Returning once again to our window diagram, now let's look at the third compartment. This is the one for operations. Once again, there's optional visibility using the same symbols we had before. There's the name. There may be a return type if the operation returns some value. It's not shown in these particular examples. Then there's a list of parameters, just like you would have if you were describing some method within an object-oriented language. The parameter list includes a name of the parameter, its type, you may express a default value, and you may also indicate whether the particular parameter is an input parameter, an output parameter, or an in-out parameter. In-out parameters are those in which the value can come in and a different value can be returned. Those kinds of adjectives, in, out, and in-out, are not shown in this particular example. In addition to the parameters in the operations section, you can give some properties. Some of those properties are expressed within the braces, like we've seen before. For example, you can indicate that a particular operation is a query operation. That is, it's only providing information about some existing attributes that within the class. You can there's properties describing concurrency. There's properties describing whether or not this particular operation is abstract, as would be seen in an abstract method in an object-oriented language. And you can also show that a particular operation has class scope. That's shown by an underline on the operation name. And what class scope means is that it's not an operation of particular instance, but an operation for the class as a whole. For example, let's say you wanted to know how many instances of vehicles you had already instantiated. You can't query any particular instance and ask it about other instances. Instead, you query the class using a class-scoped operation, and the class, if you've implemented things correctly, can provide the answer back to you.